Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Seeing you for the first time.
Yeah, calling on the call.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, man. I'm good.
Let's talk about you.
When
Would love to know what you've done.
it comes to my education, it was all about like the design part. Say, we had pattern making, we had draping, we had textile as our subjects, and yeah, less of theoretical but more of practical subjects. And my freelancing time has been into, say, like taking orders, custom orders. And then I had a tie-up with one local tailor over here. He was a migrant from Bombay. He has worked with a few garment industries in Bombay, and he had really good exposure and experience when it comes to like stitching. He was really good at it, and I had a tie-up with him for all my orders. Yeah, just explain him the orders and process the order and deliver it to the customer. Like I did it for some 6 months. And then I came up with my first collection, which was a festive wear collection. During Dashara and Diwali, I had released it. And after that was only festive wear collection I've worked on till now. But after that, it has all been sustainable and casual wear.
When you say sustainable, could you explain a little bit about what sustainability means to you and why did you want to pursue that stream?
Oh, see, Mansi, I've been reading about what's happening in the industry right from the time I joined the course, right? And how the production happens and how the whole process, from right from sourcing of the materials, then the production, then marketing, then sales, what design process they follow. So, in a nutshell, we call it as fast fashion. Right, so I've been studying about it, and I've realized that it is having a really bad impact in terms of two things. One is yourself, that is your health, be it your skin, okay, the type of materials that are being used. You see, more than around 60 to 70% of the whole manufacture of the clothes is polyester. If you consider the global statistics, okay, if you consider it is like out of the whole manufactured product, it is that percentage which is polyester, right? Polyester, it is nothing but it's made from chemical, and it is not naturally sourced how cotton or silk, which is grown in farms or which is like naturally sourced from insects or that way, there's no natural source for it.
Is it because it's easy to make? The
Yes, it is.
polyester, is that why people are going for polyester? Is it cheap?
People don't even realize what they are buying because they really don't know what they are buying, right? The problem is, if they know like what effect it will have, like today the things are changing. People are realizing, people are seeing the tags before they buy, like what this material is made of. Right, it's clearly written like what percentage of cotton, what percentage of elastane, what percentage of polyester is there in the material. So nowadays people are seeing the tags and then buying it. But back then, no. The only main point was the design. If they liked it, they went ahead with it. So that was the case. Now the realization is quite fast, and people are realizing and they are buying. They're being a little bit conscious about it.
What really like drove them to that conclusion?
Yes, because one thing is there are various platforms that are creating this kind of awareness. Okay, and earlier also these organizations, these NGOs, or they existed, but they were not working on a larger scale to create an impact in the society. But now they are coming forward, and they are trying to create that awareness among people. Okay, it has not went down to a really mass level till date, but yes, it is definitely taking its shape. Okay, so people are getting knowledge about what's happening in the industry, is getting more transparent, and then that's influencing their decisions now. People will definitely see if it is polyester, if it is they now have learned that it is not good for your skin. Okay, and so yeah, that's how it's influencing their decisions.
The fabrics that you and I should both be avoiding are any petroleum-based fabrics. These are fabrics that are polyester, acrylic, moda acrylic, nylon, spandex, and acetate. All of these fabrics need petroleum and coal and water to be created, so they're super damaging to our environment, but they're also really bad for us. I'm only gonna talk about three fabrics today because these are the three that are most commonly found in our clothing. So the first one I'm gonna talk about is polyester. And for polyester, you wanna think literally anything, tops, dresses, pants, skirts, like bedsheet covers, pillowcases, like all these things are made from polyester. I just wanna give you the reasons why I decided to stay away from these fabrics. The problem with all these petroleum-based fabrics is that when we wash our synthetic clothing, they shed a microplastic or a microfiber, and what happens is those get washed down through our washing machines, they go into our waterways, our rivers, our lakes, they make it to the ocean, and then what happens? Because plastic never goes away, it's always there. Little plankton eat it, and then little fish eat those, and then bigger fish eat those, and then we eat those fishes. So reason number one why you should stay away from petroleum-based fabrics, it's plastic and it goes into the oceans and it comes right back to us.
Do people develop skin rashes or allergies because of it? Okay, I had a personal experience, like, I don't know if I should be naming the brand or not, but yet, I bought a kurta for festive wear, and I don't know, that was the first time I wore it, and then it was hyper irritative. I mean, you know, it started itching, my skin started itching, and then I did not realize that it was because of the fabric that I was wearing, but later I found out that it's 100% polyester kurta. Yes, it was 100%. I did not realize that back then when I bought it, but yeah, it is real bad. And yeah, this is one part, that it is bad to your skin and your health. On the other hand, the making of that whole process, the whole mass production and polyester thing is really bad. If you see, polyester is made from oil, okay? And annually, it is around 300 billion barrels of oil that's being used to make polyester. So yeah. And even I have learned about these statistics very recently, and they're quite shocking. You see so many millions of barrels, oil barrels, that are being used to make polyester, right? Especially you see this, the sportswear, the tights that we wear, okay, sweatpants. So yeah, to make that, and rest of the polyester too. And yeah, they make it because it is very easy to make, and they can really go with mass production when it is polyester.
Why is that? The same thing can happen with organic cotton and linen as well, right?
Yes, but the thing what happens with natural fibers is the process gets really slow, and you really cannot get into the masses that you mass production that you achieve with polyester. If we compare our lives with our grandparents' lives, our grandparents' wardrobes and our wardrobes, how many clothes did people back then bought per year in a year, and how many clothes are we buying per year, or today's generation?
Ours keep changing every season. The trends keep changing. And I don't think back then that was the case. They just wore it for the protection for any other occasion in particular. But it did not have that fast change trends. It was just a simple...
It was more of a functional wardrobe back then. If there is a need, yes, they bought it. Else, they didn't. So yeah, earlier also there were only two seasons, you see, in fashion industry. Okay, per year there were two seasons where garments were released, the collections were released. But now you see there every week there's a new stock in the racks. Okay, and that thing is going on, and consumption of course is less, production is way more, and then more than half of it ends up in landfills.
Like
right? And like maximum percentage is polyester that will take around 200 years to decompose. When it comes to India, Mansi, you see, we don't even have properly developed landfills, right? If you compare, if you compare it with Western countries, they do have, like a technologically developed landfills, where it is concealed and whatever the kind of methane gas that is that comes out with the decompose process, that's being used to generate electricity, right? So there is some kind of process, or this, they are trying to get something out of that waste, decomposition process. But in India, you see, it is dumped in open yards. Right, when it is dumped, that methane gas is entering our atmosphere, and it is not sealed. Of course, it is not sealed. Very recently in New Delhi, they have come up with one fully developed technological landfill, and that's the only one in India as of now. That's the only one in India.
The amount of people we are in India, and the amount of land that we have, and the population growing, imagine the waste also is kind of growing along. Side.
I mean,
how scary is that?
It's almost equal to nil. There's no point having only one, technically developed landfill. Either even that thing is not happening, nor the production is stopping. You know, there's no control over production. There's no control over use of polyester, and there are no proper landfills also. So on both the sides, we are at the disadvantage.
Can imagine, it's just a depression in which we are putting waste. So what happens to all that waste? All this enters our groundwater, it pollutes our air, it pollutes the land.
इसमें स्मेल के साथ साथ ऐसी धुआं आता है, ऐसा पॉल्यूशन आता है कि जो बीमारियों की जड़ है.
Earn more and more as your economy booms, you are definitely going to buy more stuff, and it's no rocket science to say that as you buy more stuff, you're going to waste more stuff, you're going to throw away more stuff. So that is the challenge of a young developing India today.
I think India is mainly, again, we produce cotton, and there's khadi also. The brands, okay, not Western brands, but Indian brands shift their, course to polyester and not khadi.
Yeah. One thing is the rising demand for fashion. Okay.
Yeah.
It's extreme high. It's extreme high. And on the other hand, when it comes to fabrics like khadi, or be it any handloom or khadi, conscious kind of fabrics, okay, it takes a lot of time to make that fabric because it is hand done. Okay, even when it comes to khadi, even the thread is hand spun. Okay, and
be it hand in machine, is there no way where we can use khadi?
No, then it will not be called khadi.
Oh, so khadi is basically cotton?
Yes, cotton? Not only cotton, it could be a blend of cotton, a cotton or jute, a cotton or silk, or it could only be silk. Okay, there are possibilities of the combination. Okay, but nowadays, when it comes to handloom, even poly is used and blend with a handloom fabric. Okay, they call it as poly cotton handloom. Along with cotton, they mix a bit of poly threads in between.
I've seen that in a lot of clothes where it's like polyester and then cotton. So there are these mix of.
But there's no point in adding poly to a handloom fabric. I mean, why do you want to do that? Right. So on one thing is this rising demand, okay, and this huge population, this rising demand, and specifically this Bollywood industry that is creating this, that the trend cycle that people want to buy new clothes every week.
That happens, the release and the cost.
One of the biggest influencer for fashion industry. So this fashion rising demand, and on the other hand, you have this fabrics that cannot meet this demand. Okay, khadi, handloom, they cannot meet this demand, and that's the reason these brands are resorting to polyester, and they are trying to make business and reach this demand. And one more thing is the artisans, Mansi. Like back then, there were a lot of people involved in this craft of like weaving or khadi or hand spinning a thread. But now it has become way too less because their children are not into the same profession now. So the number of artisans are coming down. So yeah, it is helping in a way to polyester to make a way. Nearby me, I have like Ilkal. It's a place where Karnataka's very known textile, Ilkal saris, were made. Right, they were weaved here. It's very nearby to my place. But now you see, there are no artisans. There are no artisans weaving Ilkal saris. And earlier, it was all using natural or azo-free colors. But now, they are using chemical colors. Yeah, because there is no way out. They are not finding artisans who would make that. So even if there is demand, be it less, even very niche people choose, if they even want to choose that fabric, there are no artisans to make that fabric.
How many artisans actually existed before? And this Ilkal sari that you talk about, how what's the history of it? How long does this date back?
I'm not ready with any particular kind of statistics as of now with the number of artisans, but yeah, the last time I visited Ilkal to buy Ilkal saris, there's one person who sells this, like he has a store in his home, and then I visit him regularly to buy Ilkal saris. But yeah, what he says is now he gets those Ilkal saris from Bangalore. Okay, in and around Bangalore, there are weaving units who are making these Ilkal saris, and a lot of Ilkal saris are now made on Powerloom. Powerloom, it's like a developed version of handloom, but yet it doesn't give that texture and feel to the fabric as handloom does. So even if today you see any Ilkal sari, it would look as good as any machine made one, but not a handloom one, right? So yeah, I don't deny that there are handlooms going on, but they have reduced way too lot. I did visit their weaving unit. It's completely shut. There are no weavers at all. Only when there is orders, they try and call the weavers and make a group, and for the temporary, for order purpose, they work and then they are off the duty again.
How many weavers are we talking, roughly?
The number of weavers as of now, I don't think it would even cross 20.
What?
Yeah, I don't think it would even cross 20. They're very small.
100.
No, 100 is much better. Much better, Mansi. Like, we could have made a lot of products if there were 100 artisans available. No, they are not. They are not. Like, see, more than half of the units are already sick and they are shut. They are not even operational, and the looms, they are all, you know, they are in a very bad condition. But there are looms that are in working condition, and artisans are also less. Like, because artisans are less, there are only those many looms.
Is there a way where we can bring back this handloom production?
Yes, Nancy, we can do that, but it is going to be a tough journey because today youngsters don't want to get into that weaving profession, right? Yeah, but still, if we can train people and make groups, and then we can start making communities of weavers, because the ancestors who were into this weaving profession, they've grown old, and weaving needs a little energy to operate the loom, right? So you need your proper coordination between your hands and your legs, and presence of mind, because yeah, that's how it is done. And these present artisans have grown old, and they are not able to take that job, and they're you know, the next generation is out with jobs in other sectors. But yeah, there are works happen from government also, from private institutions also, where they are trying to train people and make a community out of it, especially for women. Especially for women in rural areas, where even they can have a financial support to their family. So they are being trained, and in many of the villages here nearby Vijayapura, where we have villages where these looms are set up in homes.
Okay.
Right? Yeah, every home has a loom. Every home. So I had been to Banahatti for my management fest, and there it was a task given to us to visit each and every home and study what's happening and what's not happening. So yeah, every home had a loom, one or two loom depending on the area available. And yeah, they were weaving saris, cotton saris and cotton or silk saris they were weaving. Yeah, it's again comparing, like, if you really want to have that in a widespread level, we need to work on it and improve that, increase in numbers.
Do you think the demand also needs to increase alongside? Because if there is no demand, these people won't have anything to make, correct? The thing is, you said about Irkal, right? Irkal sari ke alawa, there must be so many other artisans, kind of artisans who are doing different, because in India there's a lot of history that goes back to, you know, various types and kinds of crafts, be it jewelry, be it fashion, right? I mean textile. So what's happening there? Like, this is Irkal is one of them, right? One small group of the artisans. I bet there are so many others. So this, is it mainly into textile? Are these people mainly into textile? Or there's other kind of products also that are made, and they are also dying?
Yes. Apart from textiles, that is, be it khadi or hand weaving, apart from these textiles, the next part is the embroidery part. Okay, the kind of ornamentation on the textile. So you see, with this diversity of this country, there is an embroidery that comes from each state. If you consider, right, from Karnataka we have kasuti, then from Punjab we have fulkari. So that way, there are various embroidery techniques coming up in India. Like, they have been existing from the historical days. So yeah, these embroideries, one thing is, again, there's artisan issue, right? But still, they are surviving and they are getting their work orders because there are a lot of designers working with these embroideries now, right? It's not audible, Mansi. Hello?
I put it on mute because if there's any crackles going on, then I don't have to like disturb the scene.
Okay.
Just playing it safe.
So, there are a lot of designers who are working with these various craft clusters, okay, be it chikankari, be it any block printing unit, or be it, the kutch, the lambani, the rubbery work, and there are so many, fulkari, you say, and there are many, Mansi, and these designers are working with them, and that's how they are getting their, work from. Okay, and it is now on a it's growing good, I would say, but it should grow more. There should be two things happening. One is even the artisan should increase in numbers, and also the demand should increase. Both the things should go simultaneously. If you see today, lot of awareness campaigns are happening, and people are choosing hand-done embroidery, right? They are developing that taste for that kind of fashion, okay? But thing is, it is not able to reach the masses again. One thing is because of the price point. Because it is hand done and there's a lot of efforts that goes into its making, and that's the reason, and also the artisan needs to be paid a fair wage, right? So that's the reason it gets on a little more costlier note, and it's not able to reach the masses. But again, you see, Mansi, like how fast fashion evolved, right? More the quantity, there is a benefit of economies of scale, right? Economies of scale in the sense, more the quantity, your costs will get reduced. That's how this fast fashion has evolved. With the they play with quantity. That's it. They play with quantity. If you visit if you try and compare 5 to 6 brands, fast fashion brands now, you hardly see any differences when it comes to design. Right? They all follow these regular basic designs, but what they do is they play with the quantity. Okay, and they price it so less, they price it slow less with less margins, but with that high quantity, they are growing, right? So if this principle can also be applied to slow fashion, that's what I'm giving it a thought and I'm working on it. Like, of course, if the demand goes up, right, the production will go, the costs will get divided, and eventually even this the price range which is existing now, it might also come to a affordable range. Of course, it would not reduce to this current fast fashion prices. I wouldn't want that to happen also, because there's a value to it. There's a value to that hand done and that effort that has been put into it, right? So, but it would definitely come into an affordable range when it gets into a higher quantity, right? So that's what I feel, and we need to increase this demand part. Okay, and that would only happen when people will genuinely realize that they need to do it. They need to do it. It's them who have to bring that change. You see, else it's very difficult.
Do you think that people in general who buy anything nowadays have to be more conscious about where that particular product was made, and whether it is. Who is making my product? Would you ever go to a store and just like think about where it has been made, who made this product? I don't think we question it. We just be like, oh hey, I like this particular jacket and I like whatever, and then I'm just going to buy it because I saw this person wearing, or I saw it in this particular movie, and that's it. That's all there is to buying any product nowadays. And I think that's pretty sad because you don't see, even if the product is cheaply made, there is so much of, what would you say, impact, negative impact has been going to environment and also these dying crafts and artisans. So I think it's high time that we start
questioning this.
Sorry?
Yes. It's not actually cheap. It's way too costlier than the sustainable fashion when you really weigh the pros and cons of buying cheap clothes and not buying cheap clothes. By cheap, I mean, there could be a street selling, for 150 or 250, and they don't even last for a month, or even you wear it for once and it's gone. You know, that bad quality they're made of, and it's definitely polyester. So yeah, Mansi, you asked me how to create this awareness or bring that change, if I'm not wrong, right? Mansi, we can definitely bring this change. Like, I would start by saying it is definitely possible. One thing is, this young generation should be influenced with various ways. Like, we should try and influence them in their way. Like, yes, now there are things happening. There is some kind of conference going on somewhere in this country. There's some kind of awareness campaign going on in one college. Yes, of course, it would influence that number of people. But if you really want to reach the masses, right? If you really want to reach the masses, we should go influences or what the media that this youth is very much attached to, right? So it's like hitting on the right point. Say for example, the ads what you see in TVs now. Okay, have you seen a TV ad where it is trying to create an awareness for the fashion? I haven't. Say for example, if you take any product, for example, Dettol. Okay, the floor, that product, Dettol product. They're trying to create that, fear in them, where their baby is eating something that's fallen on the floor, and then he or she gets sick, right? They're trying to create that fear in them that if this happens, this is the consequence. Why is not something this kind happening with the fashion part? Why aren't there any widespread campaigns being taken up by beat anybody? I don't know what is the constraint maybe, but yeah, this is not happening. That's the fact, right? Me as a designer, yes, I'm trying my best to influence anybody, like the people I meet. I'm trying to, conduct workshops in schools and colleges. And yeah, I'm trying my level best. Like me, many designers are trying their level best. And apart from the designers, there are people who voluntarily are involved in this awareness campaign. Okay, right. For example, you, right? You have voluntarily got into this field to create that awareness with, say, Salvage Publication or your own platforms. Okay, so there are many people who activists. We can call them activists who are into this field and doing it, but they're not enough when you compare to the number of people you want to influence, right? People you want to influence is this, and the people who are influencing is this. it's a mismatch. So I would rather say, of course, this youth can definitely be influenced with various campaigns, but I would rather suggest making it a part of curriculum in schools, like be it textiles or be it about Indian crafts or a little history about how things were made back then, and how it has evolved. And at a very young age, when the child's mind is taking its shape, and that's the stage where they start forming opinions of their own, right? At that stage, you need to influence their minds. Right. So that should be included in the curriculum, where it lacks now. The thing is not happening now. And say, for example, the school uniforms could be changed.
Oh, that's
I try to. Yeah. Why aren't school uniforms made out of khadi? Why are they made out of the polyester shirt fabrics? Right. So yeah, that could be changed, you know, that from a very young age, that sentiment grows inside children. That needs to happen, so that the time they reach where their fashion needs are at very extreme, they'll choose sustainable over the polyester or the fast fashion.
Just gave a business
yes.
idea to the people watching, because this is such an interesting point, because excuse me, you just hit the nail, because the fact that it is so true that at an early age, the child really needs to understand what is harmful to the environment. Yes, we know the geography of the mountains and the plains and all of that, but this also has to be important as to what would happen if you choose products that would harm the environment, and what would happen later. Like, it is these conscious choices that they need to make for the environment and for the history to really grow. And the point where you think the school uniforms, why are they not made locally? Why they do not support these artisans who would actually help them grow in their own community? I think that's such a wonderful point of view. That's a really strong point, to be very honest. And I never thought, and now that I think back, and I'm just like, yeah, my school uniform was very uncomfortable. Because again, children play and fat jata tha, it's very sticky. And I'm like, no one liked, were they all comfortable? No, they weren't comfortable because they were made cheaply and they used to tear. And come on, for children, I think you need something that's more comfortable. Like, I think the most comfortable clothing that you need to give them. And why are they not, made out of organic or at least cotton fabrics? And that actually blew my mind. Let's go back a little. Tell me what this brand is about, and when did you form, kahan se idea aaya, aur kaise tum, how did you go about it from the very beginning? What was this hit point, there's something I need to do?
So like I said, I've been studying about, I have this kind of interest with surfing and Googling things and reading about it and getting to know the how, why, when of the things, you see. So when I was in college, that's what I did. Whatever be the topic, I used to read the the back part of it. And I realized, and I'm personally, I'm a kind of person who would a little sensitive, you say, where I would definitely not want to even kill an insect. So yeah. I am that kind of person. And of course, when I read about fast fashion, it hit hard on me. And if this is happening, there's something that is to be done. And because of my good performance in 10th exams, board exams, I was suggested to go with science and with engineering or with medical. Because of course, they are great fields, but my, my gut or, my mindset, I was only, driven towards this business part, the commerce part. And I went ahead, I took up commerce, then I did my BBA. And then when I went to fashion, I already had this in mind that I would be doing something of my own. And when this fast fashion thing hit hard on me, that's the time I decided like I would do something in this sector itself. Right, I should be doing this, and that's what that would make me happy and make me realize my career also. So it's a good thing that what you love becomes a profession. So yeah, that's how I entered this field, and then I started up and I started working. It was a very slow process. The first time I came up with a brand, it was Nukta, NUQTA. And I wouldn't say it was a brand name, but yeah, that's the name that I gave to the collection. And then I thought of coming up with a professional name for the brand that I would register. Then I came up with Ross Trans. I applied for TM. I don't know. I have no idea if I karna chahiye tha ki nahi karna chahiye tha. I have no idea. But yeah, I applied, but then I had an issue. Then I changed it to Ray. Now, Ray is an officially registered MSME, right? It's a MSME business now. I've got the certificate. And when it comes to business part, the first collection that I worked on was, it was not a handmade fabric. It was 100% cotton fabric, but it was not hand-woven fabric. Okay, but now it's that I've completely dedicated my brand to work only with handlooms or khadi or handmade embroidery, all kind of conscious and that would support so many communities out there. And that is also good for people who buy those products. And it's also a kind of upliftment to the making community out there. So, and it would also, it would bring a kind of, a thoughtful fashion. Okay, you don't buy things just to buy, right? There's a thought process that goes behind every purchase, right? I would want people to go and experience that. So that's the reason I'm working now. And it's a kind of good thing that I am based at a place where in and around I have so many weaving clusters or craft clusters that I can work with, right? So that I can work with. I've already had collaborated with two NGOs. Okay, one was from Wardha, Maharashtra, Magan Khadi. So that's the place where I interned for a month to learn the whole process of khadi, right from growing organic cotton to the complete fabric stage. And then I got trained with natural dyeing processes. And then I'm trying to implement all those principles in my brand, and come up with products. And this is also my intention, like I should, I'm working on it to make it available to as much people as possible. That's my, objective, right? I would not want to cater to a very small part of the society, but a little bigger part of the society. I wouldn't say that I would be able to cater to the whole masses, because it's definitely not possible at this stage, right? Be it the price point or be it the awareness in the public, okay? That could not be done, but yeah, a much bigger part is what my intention is. So yeah, we'll work with clusters around, we will work with handlooms, and we will work with small businesses. Say there is, the manufacturing units, be it garments or be it your accessories. Okay, there are many of them. When you go to Bangalore, when you go to Bombay, or when you go to any bigger cities where garment manufacturing happens, when I approached them, the minimum quantity they were asking for was 3,000. And definitely I would not want to work with that, you know, quantity. And I would want to keep it very in a nutshell, and so that people will also understand its value, right? When you outsource your garment production or be it any production for your products, right, there's something called as MOQ, that's minimum order quantity, right? Minimum order quantity, every business has their own acceptance of MOQs. So those units had their minimum order quantity requirement of 3,000 pieces. Okay, only if you give that high quantity order, they can process your order. That is because more the quantity, lesser the price, right? And lesser is their work, because it's going to be a bulk cutting process and everything. Every processing stage goes in bulk, and for them it is less of work and less of investment of time and money. So that's the reason they keep it so high, and because keeping it less doesn't work for them. You know, they are bigger units. They cater to really big brands who produce in masses, and they could not fit in into their schedule the production for my brand, which was way too less in quantity, right? And even if I would want to go ahead with the production, it was way too costly for me, and then I would end up making it available at a good price to the end consumer, okay, if that is the price of making, right? So that's the reason I started approaching very small units who could take up this small quantity orders. The thing I was only worried about is the quality of stitching, because even that has to be really good, and it should not be something that should be compromised on. So yeah, I did visit few, and I saw their work, and yes, now we are on a stage like we are getting our samples done. So if samples are all good, then we can go ahead with them. They are ready to manufacture in small quantity for us. So yeah, we are working our way out, you know, there's always a way out.
You and I were talking about Lambani, if I recall. So could you talk a little bit about them? How was your interaction with them, and what are they as a community?
Yes. So I had come in contact with this NGO called Hands in Bijapur, right, in this my own city. So they were into making these cotton and jute bags for export, and for few orders they also incorporated Lambani embroidery. Okay, so Lambani is that when you see this place specifically Vijayapura, it has a little, it is concentrated with this community, you know, in and around there are a lot many tandas. Tanda is a place where Lambani community resides, right? So only if it is Lambani community, it's called a tanda, right? So there are many of them, and especially these women are into this making of craft, Lambani craft. And through this NGO, I got in touch with two of the clusters, right, in and around. One is in Bellary, and one is here nearby Vijayapura, a small village. So yeah, I did not visit them, but I had their people who came to me with samples, and I also got my samples done. I came in contact with these two clusters, Lambani clusters. So one is from Bellary, and one is nearby Vijayapura city itself. So yeah, I met them and I got my samples done. The work is amazing, and the Bellary one has really like say I guess 20 artisans, female artisans who are working with this craft. And the one near Vijayapura is a really big one where they have incorporated some 2 to 3 tandas together, and they are coming up with a trust and to work under. So yeah, there are around 100 to 120 people involved in that cluster. So it's huge enough. And yeah, Lambani is, you know, it's a vibrant one, and it is, today it is, you know, going on more on a fashion side. You see, a lot of designers are working with this craft, the colorful craft. So yeah, even I would try my best to incorporate and make a collection in collaboration with them, and I hope it works. I'm trying.
So you are Rhea as a brand is, I understand that you are concentrating on being organic and supporting handloom and other small businesses and communities, and you're also open of the to the you know, idea of collaborating with other communities such as Lambani and creating different collections in future if there is a chance and an opportunity to work with them, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah. One is this artisans and crafts and people who we work with on a design part, but there are other things also, say like making of small accessories for your products, or say the production, the business B2B part of it. So even that could be outsourced to this very small units, you know, who don't get that opportunity to work on a larger scale. So even they could sustain a good amount on such orders. So I'm trying my best to help them out as well.
The ancient city Hampi is famous worldwide for its heritage and history. Not far away from here is a small town, Sandur. Known as Scotland of North Karnataka for its pristine beauty, Sandur boasts of a large population of Lambanis, the wanderers.
Namur Sushila Nagara. Sandurali bandittu nanige 24 varsha aitu. Amele batte Erodinda barutte. ಕಲರ್ಸು ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಕೋರಾನು ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ದಾರ ಡೆಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ದಾರ ಕಲರ್ಸು ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಕೋರಾನು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಮಿರರ್ಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್ಲಿಂದ ತರಿಸ್ತೀವಿ, ಕೌಡೆನು ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿಂದ ತರಿಸ್ತೀವಿ. ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ ಬರಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಇಷ್ಟು ಸ್ಟಿಚಸ್ ಇರ್ತೇವೆ.
ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಫ್ಯಾಷನ್ ಡ್ರೆಸ್ ನಮ್ಮದು, ಹಿಂದೆಗಡೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಓಪನಿಂಗ್ ಇರ್ತೈತೆ ಇಷ್ಟೇ. ಮತ್ತು ಈ ಥರ ಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಇವಾಗ ಈ ಡ್ರೆಸ್ ಒಳ್ಳೇದೇ, ಆದರೆ ತುಂಬ ಕಾಸ್ಟ್ಲಿ. ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಸತ್ತದ್ರೆ ಹುಡುಕಾಡಿದ್ರು ಸಿಕ್ಕಂಗಿಲ್ಲ. ನಮ್ಮ ಮಕ್ಕಳ ಸೋಸ್ತರ ಎಲ್ಲ ಚೂಡಿ ಮಿಡಿ ಜೀನ್ಸ್ ಹಾಕೊಂತ ಆ ಥರ ಆಗಿ ಇವಾಗೆಲ್ಲ ಇದು ಮಾಡೋದೆಲ್ಲ ಕೆಲಸ, ಮತ್ತು ಜಲ್ದಿ ಮೆಟೀರಿಯಲ್ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿಲ್ಲ.
What is your current project you're working on as of now? Is there a new collection that's going to come of Ray?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we are working with accessories collection. So I'm planning to come up with a collection of bags made out of handloom fabrics and incorporating a craft that I would release eventually. So it's on a sampling stage, and the moment we cross the sampling stage, we would get into the production stage. We would come up with designs and enter the production stage. It would definitely take time. Regularly it would take time, but because of this COVID thing, it would take a little more extra time, you know, because few labors, they're not in the city and migrated. So yeah, it is taking back its speed, but yeah, it would take time. But yeah, I'm okay with the time part of it, but the work is on, like sampling is going on. I would receive my samples in few days, and we would go ahead with the process. with coming up with a bags collection.
Oh, that's great.
So quantity, that would actually depend on what kind of production source I choose from, like various places that we have done our samples now. So it would really depend on how much capable is the unit, right? So on quantity part, we would work on a little later stage, but yeah, it would begin soon.
That's amazing. So what is your, if you have to send out a message to the generations or to the people regarding this, you know, of how they can make a conscious change, or if they want to make a conscious change in like buying products, be it textile or be it anything else, what's your take and what's your suggestion how they can do it or become better at their choices?
First thing is I would want them to understand that what they have been doing all this while, okay, they need to realize that this has already been done. Okay, what they have already done, they need to realize it. And once they try and realize that, they could eventually start. This is something that cannot happen overnight, right? It's a very slow and gradual process. Start by very small acts, you know. I wouldn't talk really only about fashion, but I would want to talk in a broader sense about your everyday complete life. Say you could decide on not using plastic at all in homes, right? Stop using plastic bottles, and whatever packaging you get, you try and decompose, clear that garbage in a particular way so that they don't end up entering the oceans or landfills. Right. So these are very small things that you can change. And when it comes to fashion, you could start buying from places where you really get good stuff. Say, if not anything, if you find that these brands you cannot afford, right? If you really want to buy a khadi kurta or handloom kurta, then you Google it on and then you find that you really cannot afford it at that right point of time. What you can do is you can go ahead, there are khadi bhandars, just buy the fabric and get it stitched, right? It is so much better than getting into stores and buying something not good for you and the planet, right? And it would also give you an advantage of design. Right, you would be wearing something that nobody else has, right? So that's a plus point you have when it comes to design. If you're really concerned about design, you should be doing that and not buy what is produced in masses, right? And the thing you are wearing is being worn by lakhs of people other than you, right? So yeah, people can make these very small changes in life, and then eventually with time they will reach that point where they are completely sustainable with themselves and their surroundings, right? It would definitely take time, but it is their own decision and their strong will that can make that happen. Else it is going to be a little difficult thing. Statistics, if you go with it, says like we are using up only 20-30% of our wardrobes, right? The whole, yes.
I just hold you on that, because I have recently been so frustrated. Why is because every morning you get up, you want to make important decisions for yourself, correct? And not think about what are you going to wear today. We don't use, as you said, the wardrobe. We only use 20% of your wardrobe. I mean, every day you're not going to wear that jacket or that pant that you bought or that kurti that you bought. I mean, that's so true, correct? So that really like shocked me. So
They have so much stuff.
It's a never-ending battle to fight the clutter.
With the baby coming, we gotta get our stuff in order.
We had to downsize from a four-story house to a two-bedroom apartment.
I lost my husband. I don't know that I have everything it takes to get rid of his belongings.
I'm Maria Kondo. My mission is to make the world happy through cleaning.
Let's start tidying.
This girl's no joke.
This is amazing.
We have too much stuff. It's official.
It's so hard to let it go.
Firstly, you need to realize that there is a mess or there is a problem in your ways of buying. Okay? So this is put all your clothes on your bed, every clothes that you own on your bed, and see for yourself the mountain of clothes that you have.
Yes, it is. It is.
Let's start there and talk about plastic. Oh, I want to first see, even if you buy a product, there is a tag which has that string that is plastic. There is the packaging, jo tumhara clothing ka bhi packaging hai, usme bhi tumhara these plastic packet hoga, uske upar wo tag hoga, all of that is plastic, boss. I mean, imagine that's only one product. The bottle or any of the other things that you buy has these kind of thing. And when I saw the heap of clothes, I was like, what is wrong with me? Because it was like, it was a big wake-up call, man. Because, I mean, how many clothes are you really wearing? And it's none. It's just like maybe 10 pieces of clothes, And so that was like, okay, there has to be some pause. I know there's these trends that's happening, and I know you want to look cool and all of that, or you're wearing it because there's this fashion trend going on. But seriously, look at what damage you're causing and where the clothes are going to land up and how it's going to be decomposed. If you are wearing a kurti, do you know who's made the kurti? Do you know what chemicals are used? When you talk about, I'm living a sustainable life and all, you need to start questioning what's in your drawer first.
Yes.
It is very important.
Everyone should start questioning that to themselves and
पहले देखो तुम्हारे कबाड़ में कितना पड़ा है so I was like okay this is if you want to talk about it you better walk the talk you can't just be there has to be sustainable brands and all of that or you don't want to a number of excuses that you would want to give. So I donated half of the clothes. It's not needed. You have a pant, you have a jacket, you have a top that you're going to wear, and until that wears out, don't buy any other clothing until and unless it's necessary for you to buy. You're going to look good anyway. And especially when it comes to women, I don't know. But it just, they have made it so difficult.
Few notions that are to be cleared that are present in the society, you see. People don't want to repeat their clothes. There's a stigma that's attached, when you repeat your clothes, you're being judged with your fashion sense or with your, the kind of closet or, they kind of judge you. So that thing should not happen, repeat, you should repeat your, repeat wear your clothes and you should proudly flaunt it. Having that fear of being judged and being responsible should be the new cool is what I feel.
Because again I tell you this also has to go with the number of functions we have being in India. Marriages hote hai. I know this is going kind of but people want to buy new clothes, they want to stitch new clothes. You paid 50,000 for this garment and you're never going to wear it, is what you're saying. How many, tell me how many weddings you might have attended and how many clothes have you gotten stitched, because that fashion is no longer, you know, is no longer applicable in this kind of, you know, 2020. जो 2018 में बनाया था तुमने कपड़ा वो 2020 में नहीं चलेगा. Why? Because no one wears it.
You should start wearing it and make a new trend.
The least you can do is mix and match. You can take that other blouse and then you can take this other ghagra and then you can mix and match, no? Is there a necessity to buy something? No, I don't think so. I really don't think so. I can still wear a 90s pants and flaunt it. I don't have to buy some other pant, because I mean, I would love to still wear bell bottoms. It's not like, oh, it's not a trend. At the end, I think what you wear and how you wear it is what really matters, not what you wear because it's in fashion or anything. At the end, that confidence has to show. I mean, regardless of whether that clothing is 20 years old or 10 years old or 2 years old.
People should like, you know, get fashionable or dress up for themselves and not for people outside. You see, and there's where the change will come. You know, you should start, you know, you dig your wardrobe, get the clothes that you're not using up, make something out of it, make something out of the old clothes that are not in use. At least, if not anything, at the end, make a broom out of it. But the thing is that do not throw it off and let it enter the landfill. Right? That should be the end objective. Okay. Make anything, you know, use it as a stuffing inside your pillow, use it as a broom or anything. If it is good enough to be worn by somebody else, you know, it is said like a one man's trash could be someone else's treasure.
Yeah.
Right. So you could give it off to someone else who could use it. So there are things, and buying like wardrobe staples is what I call, you know, you can mix and match, you can experiment with styles, and then you with just two or three outfits, you can create 10 to 12 different styles.
Yeah.
So why are you not applying your fashion creativity into that, than going into stores and applying in that and just choosing the design? So that thing could be done, and one thing is the production should stop. Other thing is whatever has already been produced, that has to be handled carefully now, because it's already produced and nothing can be done now. All we can do is manage it and not let it enter the landfills. Right. And but on the other hand, the production also should have a control now, because it's the second most polluting industry, and the amount of carbon it is emitting, okay, it is fashion industry, it emits more carbon than your, what do you say, the transport or aviation industry. No, it's way more. The statistics are horrifying, Maji. They are really bad.
And if this continues over 10 years, then I don't know what's going to happen, because I'm already
sick
of plastic. Have you seen?
Yeah,
I mean,
it's already been,
not long ago that this was just like, you know, it's not, because I think my last project was on coral reefs, and I was devastated by the news and the statistics that were shown, and now there are plastic and way there are just approaching the lands from the beaches. I mean, the beaches are full of plastic that never had plastic. You have to realize that there is a serious problem. Okay, maybe that's exactly, I have this discussion with my family as well, like, where if you're buying something, please just be conscious. Just say whether if there's plastic, try avoiding that. Don't buy that. I mean, is it necessary to buy it? Don't buy it. Buy something else. You're just creating more and more trash. If you have plastic, you don't have to discard it. You can reuse it and reuse it until you think that, you know, okay, there is time for it to go. Firstly, stop buying plastic, and then if you do have plastic, don't be like, oh, maine abhi naya khareeda tha, aur abhi, since I want to go all plastic free, don't just like start dumping it into the wasteland. That's another thing.
Yeah.
So have a control over your buying and your throwing away. And this actually reminds me of, what do you have to say on secondhand clothing?
Yes, that's what I was coming to, like secondhand clothing and the rental business that's coming up in the industry now. So there are many platforms who are coming up with this rental service for, especially for weddings. Right, you know, for wedding industry, you that's the thing. You invest really a huge amount of money, say in lakhs, and then that thing is never worn again. Okay, it stays in your wardrobe just like that. So instead of that, why don't you just rent a wedding outfit and then you give it back and you're done with it? So it's really a good thing, but it is not taking its momentum, Mansi. It should have, but I don't know what kind of stigma that's attached to this Indian community. In this community, is that if you rent a clothes, right? You know, there's some kind of harm to your respect, your dignity.
Really?
Yeah, there is. I mean, even if they rent it, they wouldn't want people to know that they have taken a piece of cloth on Bada. Right? That's because I have had this workshop with college students here in Bijapur. And I did ask people if they want to go ahead and rent their wedding outfits, you know, take it on rent. And their straight answer was a no, because wedding ek hi baar hota hai, that's the one, you know, the only time that once it happens in your life, and why you want to spoil that, this, that. It's like, no. That is the point that I want to make. Why you want to spend in lakhs for a thing that happens once in life? Yeah. Why you want to spend that? And what are you going to do with that outfit again? Okay. Are you going to wear in... Are you going to repeat it in your own wedding of your sibling? No, you'll buy again. So... I mean, a few of the answers were also like, come on, madam, bhaade pe lena acha lagta hai kya? It's against, you know, what will people say that this thing, you know, log kya kahenge? So it is attached. So it is taking its time, and I hope it grows. But with secondhand clothing, Mansi, I once come with an article, I come across with an article where all these, I guess it was a charity, you know, activity. But there's a store where each and every garment is available at, say, 10 or 20 rupees. Okay. So,
Rupees.
It was like jo kapde logon ne donate kiya hai. I don't know, I really don't remember the organization or the people who took that task up, but unhone logo,
and you can wear it. I mean, I have pants that lasted for like 10 years or maybe more. Because
then it is really good, because if you're really buying something and using it to the fullest extent, even though if it is not a sustainable material, you would still be naming it as sustainable because you have used it till the end and you did not let it impact the environment and you in a bad way, right? So, but when it comes to denim, Mansi, there is earlier, like if you go and study the history of where did this denim come from, right? Denims were actually made, it really came into existence during Industrial Revolution.
They're a style staple of people across the world. A part of our culture so ingrained, you see someone wearing them everywhere you go. Jeans. From movie stars to celebrities, to people on the street. Jeans are a part of almost everyone's basic wardrobe. But where did jeans come from? And what kind of evolution have they gone through? And what is their future? This is how jeans took over the world. Denim fabric's history can be traced back to Genoa, Italy in the 17th century. It was used for work clothes, making it a crucial textile for working-class people of northern Italy. Weavers in Nîmes, France, tried to reproduce this fabric. The end result was what we know today as denim. The word denim comes from the French phrase serge de Nîmes, meaning serge from Nîmes. There are countless brands making jeans today.
Calvin Klein, Wrangler, Lucky.
Lee?
Okay, so this during Industrial Revolution, they were in need of this really thick, durable fabric that the labor would wear when working in a factory. Okay, and back then it was a jumpsuit or a dungaree, right? Only those were the two styles that were made out of denim. Okay, because that had a lot many pockets with it to keep your tools or you're working with, you know, working at work. So to keep those tools and to really have a very hard and durable fabric, denim was introduced. But then it started taking its presence in fashion world, right? Earlier, this classic indigo, the blue denims that we see, okay? Earlier, indigo was, it was sourced from natural sources. Like indigofera is a plant where from which we get this dye, the blue dye. Okay, so, but now even that indigo is being chemically made, the color. Right, so that is very harmful, and when you release that indigo, okay, even if it's natural indigo, Mansi, even if it is a naturally sourced indigo, it is not soluble in water. Okay, it is not soluble in water. I have myself worked with dyeing of like indigo dyeing. Okay, it really does not mix with water, and it floats. Okay, there's a kind of when it comes in direct contact with oxygen, the indigo color, it forms a sheet. It forms a sheet and it floats. Okay, and it is not soluble in water. And these when these pants are made, the color that is washed out of this garments is let directly into the ocean. Right, it's very harmful to the marine animals. Okay, wow. And nowadays, if you see, when you go and really shop from streets, like that's what I have experienced. I had a jacket, denim jacket that I bought when I was on a part of street shopping. So yeah, I had bought this denim and I had been to a salon for wax. Right? And of course it was a full sleeve, tight fitting denim. And when she started, like waxing, when the process started, I started seeing blue color on the, wax strip. Not realize why is that happening. Why is my there was nothing on my skin, there was nothing on my hands, but yes, there was light a tint of blue color on the wax strip, right? By then I did not realize, but the time I reached back my hostel and when I was freshening up, then I realized it was the color of the fabric that I was wearing, right?
That layer on your skin.
Yeah,
when you got it waxed, you realize that this color of the jacket is kind of sitting on your skin.
Yes. I don't know what color was it, what fabric was it back then, but yeah, I mean, if it can sit on my skin and get absorbed into my skin, it is definitely harmful. it's definitely harmful because it's chemical.
Yeah.
So yeah, denims, I would say a big no, but yeah, the thing coming like khadi denim, and ooh, I don't know, yes, and Patanjali is a brand that has launched it, and I haven't tried it, but I should give it a try.
Oh, wow.
I should give it a try. Khadi denims is something that was, I don't know, I read about it, but in a later stage, I did not see anything around, any buzz around it. I don't know why, if the product was successful or if it was not successful. I'll still have to look into it. I just hope something of that sort comes in. Something good with denims, yeah. You see.
I would love to buy khadi denim if that's the case. Yeah.
Waiting. Let's see, like, if it comes back into the in the market. Khadi denims was, yeah, Patanjali did come up with it, but I don't know if they're still continuing to do it or
is the same Patanjali we're talking about, or is it different?
Yeah, Baba Ramdev. Yeah, Patanjali. Yeah, it is. It does. This, oh my God, there's a separate stores that he, you know, gives franchises of.
I thought he was only into making medicines.
No, medicines. Yeah, earlier it was medicines. Then it was into, you know, these regular kitchen ingredients available. And yeah, he is into fashion also.
Since when?
I don't know, from long time. I haven't kept in, you know, record of it, but I did see his, I really forgot what place I was in when I saw his store, I guess. It was not Hubli. I forgot, but yeah, there's a store dedicated to Patanjali garments, and yeah, I should look into, like, if they're really continuing the khadi denims that they had introduced once. Let's see. I hope they do.
Because
problem is, it would really have huge constraints, because denim is something we want, a fitting one, and khadi is something that is not stretchable. It is hard to work around it, but definitely possible. Definitely
probably possible. Mix it with cotton or something.
Yeah, like cotton khadi itself, it is not that.
Sure, it's like cotton and then like khadi, maybe woven together. No, form some kind of elastic, I guess.
No, Mansi, like khadi is not a, what do you say? Khadi, I would say khadi is a name of a fabric, right? Khadi is not a name of a material. No.
It's
khadi is
the name of weave. That's called
khadi. Khadi is the name of fabric where the threads are also hand spun and the fabric is also hand woven. Okay. When it comes to handloom, only the fabric is made out of, like, hand woven, but the threads are mill sourced.
Okay.
Like, only that's the only difference between khadi and handloom. Okay. So khadi is like only if your threads are made on charkha and that is made to weave a fabric on loom, then it could be tagged as khadi.
That's a long process.
Yeah, that is. And nowadays what has happened is, earlier it was, you know, hand-operated charkha, where the artisan had to really, you know, with one hand spin for long hours, you know, that started giving them like health issues with shoulder, with their back and their, you know, body positioning. But recently KVIC had made it, what do you say, it would still be called a khadi if it is spun on charkha. The charkha is solar equipped.
What, really?
Right. Yeah. So now it's like maximum of the units have solar equipped charkhas.
Jagah jagah British shashakon dwara अत्याचार होता रहा, आजादी के दीवानों पर गोलियां बरसती रहीं। ऐसे समय महात्मा गांधी जी ने विदेशी चीजों का बहिष्कार व स्वदेशी अपनाने का संदेश दिया, जिससे देशवासियों में एक नई उमंग पैदा हुई। आजादी के दीवानों ने विदेशी कपड़ों को आग लगा दी और शहर शहर गांव गांव में लोगों ने हाथ में चरखा पकड़ लिया। समय बीतता रहा, इस तरह प्रत्येक ट्रेनिंग कम प्रोडक्शन सेंटर से लगभग 1000 महिलाएं रोजगार से जुड़ सकती हैं। वो घर बार भी देख लेती हैं, साथ ही अपने बच्चों व परिवार का
पढ़ाई लिखाई अपना ऐसे मेंटेनेंस पुराने से एक कमाने से कुछ नहीं होता, अपना घरेलू भी काम भी करते हैं और चरखा भी चलाते हैं, इससे 250 रुपये प्रतिदिन हम सब कमा लेते हैं।
हम लोग हर दिन प्रत्येक दिन 1 किलो सूते काटते हैं घरेलू काम करते हुए। पहले मेंटेनेंस पति करते थे, अब थोड़ा बहुत हर औरत धागे काट के और मेंटेनेंस बाल बच्चा के।
They're not hand operated anymore. It would still need an operator because they
but
need to align
with the movement. That one case,
movement will not be there. Yeah, this movement will not be there. But still, there would be an artisan for charkha.
Charkha and then
for charkha they need to operate that. There's a small battery thing that is solar equipped on which the whole charkha operates. So if you not maybe now, but someday we can really talk about how the charkha works. It's amazing. It's amazing.
Really?
Would love there to. Is so
and
much.
We definitely should have like part 2 series. This is so very honest. This is very important.
Yes.
See, I don't know half of what you know. I mean, the amount of knowledge that you have regarding the way it's made and how it's made, it is very important for people to know. I mean, it's not just, again, there's lot that goes into making a product.
I mean, what I feel is like if this whole process is shown to the public outside, like how is it made, I'm very sure like there would be very less people who would not fall in love.
It's not the product, but it's the story that really sells as to like why I should be buying it. And I think that supporting these brands like yours, Ray, it's very important to,
It will, man. It is definitely taking its shape. If you see the global, globally in numbers, the number has reached to 80% of the population who are actually trying to understand what they are buying and then buy. It is going in good numbers. In India, it is, I understand it's quite less because it is taking its speed. The speed is quite slow, but yes, eventually it will. On global level, it is on a higher note because I don't know. There are factors like literacy or the kind of lifestyle, their thought processes, you know, at a very young age, they are exposed to, you know, having their own opinion and kind of stuff. But in India, it takes up a little time and it comes at a later stage. But it is going on a good note, I would say. It is taking its shape.
I still have a hope for the younger generation that's coming, that's before us, because I'm sure they're so much more well aware. Because again, I think internet plays a really big part as to, firstly, we're seeing what's happening around the world, be it disasters in the environment, be it new fashion trends or new ways of making things, again, sustainability. All of that is there's a globe. This is a global platform now. Internet has become a global platform. So again, there are advantages and disadvantages. But who is using the internet? I think it's the youth that's 18 to 25 years old. I think they are really driving the wheel right now, and I think they are really going to help make this impact even larger than this generation or our older generation that is already a tree cannot be bent once it's grown, and let's say that. And I think the youth is really much more wiser and aware, and I've seen people want to change. They are talking about changing, and I think COVID also did bring a huge wake-up call, because after the lockdown, I heard a news where this lake near Mumbai turned pink.
Recently, in Navi Mumbai, flamingos put on quite a show for the residents of SeaWoods. Their arrival is not new, but this year, the sheer quantity in which they have arrived is a beautiful sight.
And there were flamingos, and I'm like, what? I mean, imagine in a city like Mumbai, there are flamingos coming, and the city, like the lake, is turning into like color pink. I mean, and again, the nature was thriving in this thing. And imagine this includes the industries and the pollution that it caused. Because of the industry stopped manufacturing what products they were manufacturing, the lakes and the rivers started clearing up.
Yeah.
And it's sad that it's going to go back. To some extent.
It is. It will, Mansi, it will. And again, it is going to take a lot of time for people to realize and come to a stage.
Only if you start shifting your perception, where, you know, instead of A, you start choosing B, because B is the better option. It could be a little expensive, but I'm saying I wouldn't mind, you know, throwing in some $100 extra, because it has so many other plus points than that thing that's cheap and is whatever, trending. And it really doesn't make sense. I mean, it just doesn't, at least anymore. So that is very important.
Because people are very thinking like from that particular point of view. Like they don't think from a longer perspective, right? For now, they are buying clothes, say like 200 rupees a t-shirt, 300 rupees a t-shirt, and then they throw it off in a week or in a month or so. But then stop buying such 2-3 items and buy a good one, say for 1,000 plus rupees, and use it for a way longer time, right? That thing should come.
From today, I think I'm going to change my way I shop.
Really?
Oh, yes.
Oh, my God.
Large bodies of water are disappearing because cotton is so thirsty. Before I started travelling for this documentary, I knew almost nothing. I was fairly familiar what went down from a human perspective, the human cost, but the environmental cost, I wasn't informed at all.
Hi, how are you? I'm Stacey, nice to see you.
Thank you.
Can we borrow you for 5 minutes? What have you been buying?
My mum bought this. She bought a jacket.
So show me what you've got in your bag. Ah, so a hoodie.
Yeah.
And is it cotton?
Yep.
This is 100% cotton. Brilliant, interesting. So how much water, Johnny, do you think has gone in to growing the cotton necessary to make this jacket?
Probably about 800.
800?
Yeah.
70 litres?
20, 30 litres?
20 or 30 litres?
Yeah.
Growing the cotton?
Yeah.
To make that jacket?
Yeah.
Will have taken 10,330 litres of water. 4,580 litres of water. 10,800 litres of water just to grow the cotton to make that jacket.
I can't believe this.
Sorry, it's actually blown my mind. Oh my God.
It's 13 years for one person.
Which is goodness, for one
ridiculous
shirt.
Right? 24 years of drinking water for one person.
24 years.
That's wild, right?
That is wild. It's crazy.
That shocks you?
It does shock me, yeah.
How does that make you feel? You look visibly shocked.
Yep.
25 years of drinking water for one person.
Oh, wow. And that's for two items. Oh, I'm a horrible person.
Do you really need that jacket as much as someone needs 10,000 litres of water? No?
I'm sorry to get upset, but... yeah.
Tell me why you're so emotional about that fact.
Yeah, because I know people, they are struggling to get water for drink or to wash or to cook. And we are using for making this.
You make me feel bad here. I mean, gotta go return it.
Does it make you think that you might shop differently or you might give this
a
bit more thought?
From today, I learned something. I think I'm going to change my way I shop.
Really?
Oh, yes.
You really mean that? It's
yes,
very easy
I mean
to
it.
Say.
I swear. I mean it.
Oh, my God. I do truly believe that it's not that people don't care. We're just not informed. So I'm absolutely the worst because I'm a nightmare. I shop all the time. And so I don't think we know enough. And I think it's about just trying at least to shop responsibly.
And there will hope, hopefully. I mean, there is still hope. I know that there is hope, and I think...
There is hope, there is hope. With this younger generation, there's definitely hope. And you see, there are a lot many middle-aged... sorry, I don't have any idea when it comes to the men community because I haven't interacted with them much of that age. But when it comes to women, like, I'm a part of this Inner Wheel Club, mm-hmm. right? Like almost the whole club consists of middle-aged women who are like say they're 30 plus and they're in 30s and their 40s and 50s and they're in 60s and many old age people also, right? I have seen that we have regular meetings, we have exhibitions and a lot of get-togethers going on, right? All of them, most of them, they are entrusted with this sustainable thing, right? And that's really a good thing. I don't know if men community of that age is really interested in this topic or not, but women are definitely. They have started realizing the beauty of handmade things, okay? The beauty of wearing sustainable fabrics. You know, they find it more graceful than what they buy from XYZ stores outside, right? So it's a good thing. I mean, it's a proof that there is a shift happening. Yeah.
That's amazing to really encounter. I mean...
Yeah, I mean, so we had our second exhibition at Belgium Inner Wheel Club. There was a get-together from where women from North Karnataka, Maharashtra and Goa had come. a few parts. And that's a place where I had exhibited my brand with products from two NGOs and my products of my brand also. So you wouldn't believe, Mansi, we could, it was very like, you know, very good output. So say the footfall for the exhibition for like very genuine footfall for only for 4 hours. Like 2 hours before lunch and 2 hours after the lunch hours, but we could really make a very good business during those 4 hours, right? People were coming in, they were talking to me about the brand story. Can you imagine, like, say, at now in this day, 50 plus women, they're coming to me and they're speaking to me like, how you made this, who are the people who are making this, and what materials do you use, are there chemicals inside. They were really interested with the story and more than the product, you see. And we could generate 20,000 plus business in just a 4 hour period. Right, it was a tremendously good response from that set of women, you see.
So even wow, such a small number would have such a big impact. Yeah. I think it's quite enough.
Wow. It was amazing. And they really have that lot of respect for art, for craft, for handmade things. You know, we have our WhatsApp groups where during this quarantine also they have, you know, started decorating their houses with handmade stuff and started sharing pictures. The competitions arranged and then, you know, winners are announced. They keep doing things. They keep doing things. And it's good that these things are happening.
If someone wants to be a part of this Innoville Club, how could they be a part of it? If they want to be part of this Innoville Club, is there how would someone, if interested, be a part of it?
The Innoville, it's actually on the international level, national level, and their clubs are really you know, spread across even district or less than a district places also. Like even in taluka places, there are these small groups. And they are connected with a next level group. Next level groups are connected with another. And then they are ultimately connected to the Innoville Club at national and international level. So if you want to become a member of that, it's a women only club. It's a women only club. And say for example, Bijapur has two Innoville clubs. And Hubli has five. Hubli has five, and trust me, Mansi, all of them are really amazing. I had approached the president of each Innoville club in Hubli because I wanted response for my survey that I had taken up. Right, it was a survey in this in the field of Sadi. I needed as much responses as possible for that survey from Bijapur and Hubli. So I contacted these clubs where most of the women are members. And then, the support was really good. They started spreading the survey forms by themselves and started getting responses for me. They were really cooperative. It's good. Definitely good.
It's always good to see other generations also, like, you know, have this interest in the, you know, the same belief. They all have the same, you know, enthusiasm in believing that there's a need for change. And I think the more numbers are going to, again, drops make the ocean, I would say. So I think once more numbers start joining in, I think there's going to be a huge you know, change in another revolution, I would say, industrial revolution. I think over 5 years there has to be significant change in the way the consumerism is going to you know, start buying things and the way they're buying things. I'm sure
5 years. See, if you consider other brands also, like these existing fast fashion brands, So even consider like Zara or consider H&M. So even they are promising that in coming years they would turn completely sustainable and conscious. But yeah, there's a resolution from Government of India also, like SURE, S-U-R-E, sustainable resolution, sustainability resolution. So in that, around 16 brands, say like brands like companies like Max, Lifestyle, Pantaloons, kind of 16 brands have collaborated. They have become a part, and by 2025. They have to like turn conscious and sustainable to the maximum extent possible. So yeah, they are working on it. It's the Minister of Textiles and CMAI and initiative, right? So
that's CMAI, a really good start. It was
launched in the sustainable day of Lakme Fashion Week. Out of the whole week, there is one day dedicated to sustainable fashion with Lakme Fashion Week every year, every season. So one of the last seasons, they have launched it. SURE is the resolution, sustainability resolution.
I can't wait to like see designers collaborating. Brands also collaborate. Big brands collaborate. I think collaboration is going to multiply the numbers even faster.
I think that has happened. Yeah. It's a slow process, but sure, it will happen.
Okay. I think we pretty much covered a lot and create insight. The only thing is there's so much information. jog, because we kind of went like that.
It's
never ending. It's never, because there's so much to talk. It's not enough. But this is great, dude. Like, we gave so many business ideas along the way. I hope you know that. I hope that it's like seen by a lot of like people, and they kind of like, you know, realize that there's so much to it. You know, that's crazy insights. The kind of how it's made and what the industry is like and what the government is doing and what are the communities doing. I'm so glad to have this conversation, because it's so important. And when you club minds who talk about on the same platform, there is enormous amount of ideas, enormous amount of realization that comes along, because you will have certain kind of experience and knowledge on certain things, and the products are vast. The amount of opportunities is vast. So, but it's important to know that there is a problem, and I'm glad to be connecting with people who talk in the same terms as even you did. Completely blown away. I'm serious, I'm not joking. This is such an insightful interview. I didn't know half of the things. Khadi, I thought was a material.
But there's a lot of, malpractices also in the industry, Nancy. So you should be careful of it also. Like people, there are machine-made, there are mill-made fabrics being tagged as khadi or handloom, and they are being sold. And even that thing happened.
To
be frank, it is little difficult for a layman, right? For people who have worked in this sphere will understand, by knowing the touch and feel of the fabric, right? So, but for, you know, it's really difficult for a layman to understand. What we can rely more on is the place we are buying from and how much authentic or how much certified is the buyer, sorry, the seller.
Yeah.
You see, so if they have certifications and even if they are making promises, on what basis are they promising you X, Y, Z? So you, not just that you go just run into a store and buy khadi fabric. Okay, it might be genuine or it might not be genuine. Chances are more that it is not genuine, right? There are people outside who sell genuine khadi in their stores, right? But there are like way more stores who don't do that. Right. So you, people should make sure that they buy it from a certified seller, or if they really have good understanding of how a khadi fabric would feel, then you have the, have that in your hands, so you can make a decision on that. But I would definitely tell that you know, like machine made or mill made fabrics is like, it is very much finished, and the feel of it, the feel and the texture of it is quite you know, very completely finished and on both the sides. So you need to check the front and back side of the fabric. And then yeah, but there are ways to
completely clean. This is again when you talk about khadi, it has to have that.
But again, now the thing is, the people are like the mill clothes. They are trying to imitate that texture also. It gets way more difficult now to recognize a genuine fabric. So I guess we should rely more on certifications and authentications that the brands have. So that would really help us. That, or if you can buy from, say, a registered cooperative society who source from artisans around, say, I have been to DAMA, Dastakar Andhra Marketing Association in Hyderabad. So I have specifically been to visit their, you know, their store and see the fabrics. You know, such organizations, they have genuine products. So we know that, and then we can straightforward go and buy it, not worrying about it.
If you still have questions, I guess you can, you know, we can come to you and then you can guide us as to.
Yeah, anytime. midnight is also fine. I have no problem. Anything to help with this sector.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, trying to give my 100%.
Yeah. We are super excited for your launch of the products. All the best on, I hope there is more products and more things coming up.
I'm trying my best to, like, you know, speed up the process, because it's been way long time that my brand hasn't come up with a collection, and that's because there were a lot of back-end activities going on for my brand to get it on track with the business part of it, or say, you know, just
there are always bumps in the way. It's a smooth process.
So I'm like, let me not just be like hurry in this process. Let me give it its own time to evolve over time, because even I am learning with time, and so is my brand.
Okay, that's pretty much it. Would you want to add something else?
To add, I would just say, like, start thinking on, like, start retrospecting your day. Like, don't retrospect your life, but for today, start retrospecting your today. The day you have spent. In the night, just sit and just think, what have you done, what have you worn, and what are their impacts, and try and make a change to a better one. You know, I wouldn't say in a day just go 100% good, but get better day by day with your choices. So is what I want to say. Small steps.
That's so true.
And believe, have that faith and belief on your small steps. Just because, just after taking few steps and you don't see any results, don't just drop. Because this is a slow process, it would take its own time to give out its impact. Give it its own time to evolve, you know. You'll definitely very soon see the impact. So yeah, that's the message I would want to send. And stay conscious, think conscious, and act conscious. Yeah.
That's at least, and hoping I can meet incredible minds like yours, who has immense knowledge in terms of this. I mean, I wouldn't be able to say what you had to say. I mean, we can have series of it. I have absolutely no problem with that. But this was such a wonderful session. Be very honest. I mean, come on, I think thanks to you, you made that happen.
Really happy, even if you, like you said, you're not much into the technicality of the industry, but yes, you are taking your steps ahead in the same direction like we are working on. So it really doesn't matter if you're connected to the industry or if you're not. It really doesn't matter. All matters is your intention and your will to make a change.
Your inspiration. Do you have the same amount of inspiration? I think it's going to take
you so
a week to edit this video, because it's 2 hours long. Full information. Shots fired here and there.
Chal. Bye. Bye.
I hope you're not tired. Because you talk.
No, not at all. When it is this topic, I would never.
No, not at all. Same.
Anytime. It's like, neend mein bhi utha ke poocho ke sustainability kya hai, to main shuru ho jaungi.
That's great. I like it. All right.
Chalo.
Okay, chalo. Bye.
Thing happening.
Also. Yeah, here too. I was like, don't start now. Wait, hold on.
I guess they're getting it now.
That is not going to stop. The cracking of the crackers.
Very bad.
Oh, you hear me?
Yeah, it is.